seen, if actually around the country, because we got a lot going on, but we have a lot going on in Boston. And I have to say that Boston has a lot of challenges. There's no question. As I come back to my hometown, actually, I was there about a month ago, and I was looking at some of the development that is going on, a large amount of the development. Black folks aren't on the jobs. Black folks aren't making the decisions, and Black folks are underemployed. Actually, I was looking at information on a U.S. postal zip code finder, because I needed to find a zip code. Long story short, I looked at where I live, in the metro Washington, D.C. area, and the average income was $140,000, a reasonable income for the neighborhood that I live in, average income. Then I went and looked at my hometown of Roxbury, and you should do the same thing. It's $27,000 average income in Roxbury. We got a problem, folks. And there's people that know about this and are not doing anything. And then there are people that have done things all their lives. And one of the people that has done the work all of his life is my good friend, Bill Wright, who I've asked to come on the program today to talk politics with me. And so here's the deal. Let me talk about Bill Wright. Bill Wright, and by the way, his resume is amazing. Former public information director at UMass. Yeah, president's office, former director of communication at the Boston Housing Authority, former communications director at Boston City Council, former English high teacher, and former communications director
at recording New in York. Progress.
Listen, I'm talking about New York State, like the state of New York. Yeah, and New York State Senate. Studied political science at Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Listen, this man's background is amazing, and wait until you hear from him. Studied sociology at Columbia College and Columbia University, and studied journalism at Columbia University at the City of New York. He went to Boston Latin School. Lives in Boston. He's from Medford, Massachusetts. Welcome, Bill Wright.
Thank you, Leon Block. I appreciate your giving me that rundown of things that I've done. I'm exhausted.
And well, you should. And I didn't even talk about your basketball years. And you, listen, everybody knows Bill Wright as the master of basketball. Everyone. Who doesn't know Bill Wright? Come on now. So, Bill, we appreciate you. We love you. You've been doing some phenomenal things. I've been reading on your Facebook, Twitter, and all the rest of your social media pages. And you talk about everything about politics. You follow it left and right. You've been doing this stuff. What are you thinking about politics in Boston and how we see it today? And I give you a broad question because we get a lot to talk about. So let's do it broadly first. What are you thinking about politics in Boston, particularly in the African-American community?
Well, Leon, you know, as you mentioned, the average income disparity, say, in Roxbury versus, the part of Maryland you live in, right? In Boston, the Federal Reserve in 2015, I believe it was, did a study of the income disparities between white families and black families in Boston. And in 2018, the Boston Globe wrote a story about that. Mm-hmm. And what they published was that the average net worth of a white family in the city of Boston was approximately $247,000. Mm. And that the average net worth of a black family in Boston was $8. You know that number between 7 and 9?
That's absurd. $8. Yes.
Of course it is. And you know very well as a Bostonian that that result has been generations in the making.
Correct.
Lack of quality education, lack of access to jobs, lack of adequate health care, all of the particular ills that, you know, many cities in this country have overcome, they have still had a tremendous detrimental effect on the people of Boston, the black people of Boston in particular.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my interests, of course, is the mayor's position in this city. I've known the mayors since Kevin White, when he was elected in 1968,
mm-hmm.
through the administrations of Ray Flynn and Tom Menino and Marty Walsh, who is the labor secretary for President Biden right now. And we, of course, had the interim mayor, Kim Janey, the first black person to be in that position.
Mm-hmm.
And in last November's election, the city elected Michelle Wu as the new mayor of the city of Boston. Now, you may be well aware that there were five candidates in that race initially, and two of them had announced in 2020 prior to Joe Biden selecting Marty Walsh to be his labor secretary.
Mm-hmm.
It just happens that Biden made that announcement on January 6th of 2021, the day of the horrendous insurrection at the Capitol.
Mm-hmm.
And it was not until April 6th, 3 months later, that the interim mayor, Kim Janey, a black woman, jumped into the race, where you already had Andre Campbell, a black city councilor, in the race. The effect of that was, of course, to split the black vote, of which in the preliminary there are about 45,000 votes.
Mm-hmm.
And had Kim Janey not jumped into that race 3 months late,
mm-hmm.
then Andre Campbell would receive the Boston Globe endorsement, who had raised about $3 million of the $4 million total raised, would likely be the mayor of the city of Boston today.
Wow. Well, that's a statement in itself, because what happens is when we have to have some successes, and we have had some successes in the city with the judges that get appointed, lawyers that get appointed to positions of authority that are African American. We've built some successes over the years, but politically, we have had some challenges. And one of the biggest challenges, I think, and this was a no-brainer for me, was why would so many black and other people of color attempt to get the position of mayor and split the vote? What was, explain the logic behind it, though. Was there any logic?
It's lacking in logic. But, you know, the former mayor of Seattle, Charles Royer, mm-hmm. left Seattle in order to become the head of the JFK Institute of Politics at Harvard.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing so, he opened the door for City Councilor Norm Rice to be elected the first black mayor of Seattle,
mm-hmm.
when the city of Seattle only had a 10% black population.
Wow.
Now, compare, and when I spoke with him in Seattle and at the Kennedy Institute,
mm-hmm.
he told me that he enjoyed being mayor of Seattle for two terms,
mm-hmm.
but he wanted to get back to the power corridor.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, for him, the power corridor was Boston to Washington, D.C.
Mm.
And
wow.
if you look at that on the map, mm-hmm. you'll see that even in Hartford, Connecticut, there was a female black mayor.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at New York, if you look at New Haven, look at all of these cities along the East Coast, Atlanta, Baltimore, Richmond, down all the way to New Orleans. Not only have those cities had black mayors, most of them have had more than one black mayor.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the mayor of Chicago is a black woman. The
Correct.
Mayor of San Francisco is a black woman.
Correct.
The mayor of Houston, Texas is a black man.
Yep.
So why is Boston so different from those places? I would say that many of those localities, the people, the black people involved in politics in those cities, figure out how to not bump heads between two strong candidates.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you look at the history of Chicago and Harold Washington, one of the things that helped Harold Washington become elected as the first black mayor of Chicago was that Richard Daley Jr. and Jane Byrne were both in that race, and they split the white vote.
Mm-hmm.
The white Democratic vote.
Right.
In Boston, we ended up splitting the black vote. And one of the most devastating things that I heard from a Boston Globe editorial reporter was that she had spoken with interim mayor Janey during the race, and Janey had said to her that she never thought that Boston would ever have a black mayor, and secondly, that she never thought that it would be her.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I can tell you that a person like Andrea Campbell, who went to Boston Latin School, was a student who graduated from Princeton University, who earned her law degree at UCLA Law School, who sat in that Latin School auditorium and saw the names John Hancock, Benjamin Franklin, George mm-hmm. Santayana, etc.
Right.
She could imagine being the mayor of Boston,
mm-hmm.
the governor of Massachusetts, or mm-hmm. the President of the United States, and I would not be surprised if she received a campaign contribution from Michelle Obama, who, of course, also went to Princeton.
Right.
So why, then, was Janey in the race?
Mm-hmm.
My conclusion is that certain people around her sold her a bill of goods, that this was just like Ray Flynn, the former mayor, going to the Vatican, appointed by Bill Clinton,
mm-hmm.
where City Council President Tom Bonino became the interim mayor and then became the next mayor. But even if she believed that scenario, it still does not explain the 3 months delay in entering the race, because as you know, Leon, from campaign, people start locking up political operatives. And, of course, they start collecting campaign funds.
That's right.
So as the interim mayor, and of course, Tom Menino, as soon as he heard that Ray Flynn was going to the Vatican, Menino was on the phone, you know, lining up his people and his contribution.
Right.
Right. So that remains a mystery as to what the thinking was. And also, to a certain extent, the local media in Boston have been in cahoots with the local government for years.
Mm-hmm.
Why have we not seen interviews with either Campbell or Janey about what went on there?
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Campbell currently is running for attorney general statewide,
mm-hmm.
so you can understand she's not wanting to bring that up.
Right.
But Janey is no longer in elected office,
mm-hmm.
yet no Boston paper or TV station has gotten that interview with her, right?
Mm-hmm.
To explain what happened.
Well, you're bringing up this topic, and I'm glad that you are, because I asked the broad picture, what's going on with Boston politics, and particularly in the African-American community, and you bring up the issue of who is the mayor, and how did the new mayor get the power to be the mayor, and who were the players that assisted the mayor in getting in? Who were the black and other people of color players that were in the race that actually catapulted the mayor, Wu, to be running the city? And you're saying in many ways that you have to look at all the candidates and how black folks year after year split the vote. Just jump in and everybody runs and everybody says, I have a right to run. And the black person loses, particularly in the mayor's race. And it happens consistently. Every 4 years, you see a bunch of black folks and a bunch of Latinos jump into the mayor's race and it gets split up. And then we have to wonder, and I'm glad that you're bringing this up, Brother Bill Wright, by the way. We're talking with Bill Wright here on All Things Black Politics. And Bill, when you say these things, there's a point where you have to ask the question, when do we hold ourselves accountable for our actions or inactions? And so I think that's what you're saying, right? Is that there needs to be coverage, and I'm glad that you're bringing it out today, coverage about this issue, because people see things, particularly the Black voters. And there's a point where Black folks don't even come out to vote because they say, what's the point? They're going to split the vote anyway. Am I wrong?
Well, you're right about that. And actually, we have some of the lowest turnout for municipal elections that you can imagine, sometimes in a range of 10 to 15% of people who are actually Black people who are registered to vote who still do not vote. Mm-hmm. Now, Charles Hamilton, who you know, the professor who wrote the Black Power book with Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture, he actually was a professor of mine at Columbia Journalism. Mm-hmm. And he talked about people will participate in politics if there is a product, if there is a result that's beneficial. Now think about that $8 net worth. Mm-hmm. How many Black families in Roxbury, as you and I were growing up, would regularly contribute to politicians' political campaigns? When you have $8 net worth, you don't have discretionary funds to provide to campaigns. And as Hamilton would have said, Black people write a check and they expect to get a service or a product right now. Mm-hmm. Now, if you read the last hurrah, and which talks, of course, about how the Irish moved up politically in Boston, they came to understand, of course, the power of their vote, right? Mm-hmm. And by getting out to vote, they were able to get people into office, and getting people into office means jobs, means money. Mm-hmm. So 18-year-olds in Irish-American households better not come back into the house without having registered to vote, or they're not getting dinner. In a neighborhood like where former Mayor Marty Walsh lives in a certain section of Dorchester, they say that 3 out of 4 people living there work for either the city, state, or federal government. And I don't think that's an exaggeration, because they figured out how to get the benefit of the system.
That's right.
So when you're collecting signatures for candidates, and I do some of that as a volunteer for a certain Black candidate, so many people will not only say to you that they're not registered, but often they will say, I don't even vote, almost with pride.
Right.
And then you have to say to them, well, do you pay taxes? Mm-hmm. And if they answer yes, then you say, look, if you pay taxes, you work, you pay taxes, then somebody decides where that tax money goes.
That's right.
How much comes back to your neighborhood or goes elsewhere? Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, in the city of Boston, with the kind of snowstorms we have sometimes, if you're the mayor of Boston, Leon Rock, and you got a major snowstorm, right? Mm-hmm. Where do you think you're sending the snowplows first?
To the neighborhoods that supported me.
To support you in where people vote religiously.
Exactly.
If you're at the Roxbury Boys and Girls Club on Warren Street on election day, a person can walk up to the building, walk inside, and they can be walking out 5 minutes later having voted.
Correct.
If you're at Holy Name Church in West Roxbury on election day, you're in a long line.
Yes.
And so when Edwin O'Connor wrote his book, he was showing the blueprint of how the Irish immigrants, who were told, of course, no Irish need apply, and they couldn't get jobs, and they had to take the lowest jobs and so forth. Right. He was showing the formula that the power that they had was their vote.
Correct.
That's the thing. So if that's the one political power that you know you do have, and as you know, Leon, it's free to vote, right?
Well,
there's no more poll tax, right?
Well, they're trying to.
But there's no question here.
In the southern region of the country, they would love to bring back the poll tax. They would love to restrict the way you vote. In Atlanta, as you know, or Georgia, they have the situation where you pass someone some water while in an 80, 90 degree temperature, out waiting to vote for 5 hours, you pass someone some water, it's illegal. So they tried to bring it back. But as you said, right now it's free.
And many of those folks are elderly who still go out there and vote despite those conditions and those ridiculous rules.
That's right.
You know, I'm glad you mentioned Atlanta, because Atlanta is one of the prime examples of why it can matter to have somebody elected mayor of the city.
That's right.
When Mayor Jackson became the mayor of Atlanta, that's within the 60s, right? Mayor Jackson went and visited all of the major banks in downtown Atlanta. And after walking around, he would look at the executive, the CEO or the president, and he would tell them, I don't see many people of color, black people, Latinos, and I see a few clerks here and there, you know, but I don't see people in the suites upstairs where people are earning the highest salaries and making the major decisions. So what I'm going to do is give you a month, and I'm going to visit again. And if I find that that situation has not changed dramatically, I will take the City of Atlanta's financial deposits that are in your bank out of your bank.
That's
and
right.
Put them elsewhere.
Yes.
So you know quite well, had Mel King been elected in 1983, had Charlotte Paula Ritchie been elected in 2013, which was another splitting the vote situation, the city would be a different place today.
That's right.
Simply because the people heading the department would have been more diverse individuals than has been the case. And it turns out that when the two black candidates, knocking both of them out of the final election, we ended up with Michelle Wu, a person who's very talented, very intelligent, but who came here from Chicago to go to Harvard, and Anissa Asafi George, who's a former school teacher who grew up in Boston, and was a person who was seen as the Marty Walsh surrogate in this race.
Right.
So then you have black people saying, which one of those two people should I vote for, right? And we also had the burden of having had an appointed school committee for about 20 years. Now, you can remember that running for school committee was the method in which black people and Latinos learned how to run for office, how to manage a staff, how to organize people,
how
to raise funds, right? How to deal with the media. When you don't have that for 20 years, where does a person who's not from the bowling family of politicians or has some other kinds of support or training, where do they learn how to run? In New York City, they have political clubs. And in those political clubs, if a seat opens for the state senate or for the state assembly, within the club, say in Harlem, there's a debate between candidates, and then the entire group supports the best candidate. That's why when I worked in the state office building in Harlem on 125th Street and Adam Clayton Powell Boulevard, the politicians who were in office included Congressman Charles Rangel, State Senator Carl McCall, Mayor David Dinkins, Manhattan Borough President Percy Sutton, and former, Secretary of State of New York Basil Patterson, the first black person elected statewide, whose son David, who was legally blind, a Columbia graduate, later became the governor of New York State. And why did those people have those positions? Whenever somebody ran, they all supported each other.
Exactly. Yep, you broke it down, Bill. That's exactly the challenge in Boston, is that black folks, generally speaking, that are in positions where they want to run for office, they don't support each other. They say that they're the best candidate for the position and sometimes don't even have the quals. Actually, you have folks that have been running religiously since the time I left Boston 30 years ago, 40 years ago. Same candidates running for office, never getting elected, and they just keep on running. And black folks in Boston don't say stop, stop.
Right,
enough
right.
is enough. You know, stop.
Right, like of course, there's a consistent candidate. Named with last name Owens.
Yes,
and there once was a candidate whose name was Ed Brooks, which of course was similar to Ed Brooks, the former U.S. senator.
Yeah.
Another thing about that, you mentioned the House of Representatives Mm-hmm. In 2018, Ayanna Pressley was elected from Boston as the first black member of the House of Representatives. Now, you know, as a historian, that Ron Dellum from Oakland, California, was elected to the House in 1970.
Mm-hmm. Sounds right.
So it took nearly 50 years for the first black House member to be elected here in Boston.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened that during the race where she ran against Michael Capuano, who had been a 20-year Congress member from Somerville, Don Lewis came to Boston and went to 12th Baptist Church.
I know.
And John Lewis endorsed Michael Capuano
for
Congress. Now, there's two things about that. Yeah. First of all, the question would be for me, who did John Lewis speak with in Boston, who is black, about that situation before he endorsed his colleague, Michael Capuano?
Right.
Like, the other thing is, Leon, I would find it hard to see someone like John Lewis traveling to Harlem, West Side Manhattan, you know, where congressional race was going on.
Right.
And deciding to endorse the white candidate rather than the well-qualified black candidate.
That's right.
Believe me, brother, in Harlem, that would not happen.
Yes. Right. And, but it happened in Roxbury. It happened in Dorchester. It happened in Mattapan. It happened in Boston, where John Lewis, may he rest in peace, got bad advice and endorsed the wrong candidate, and the candidate lost. Capuano, or whatever his name is.
With 20 years in. And it also reflects not having done the due diligence that he and his staff, John Lewis and his staff, should have done prior to him making that decision to endorse Capuano. And then, of all places, 12th Baptist Church.
Isn't that
the home church of Reverend Michael Haynes?
I know. Isn't that was an insult, actually. We're talking with Bill Wright. You know, he is a phenomenal man, a educator. I know he's an author because he is a writer for sure. As much research as he has done on politics nationally, internationally, and locally is amazing. And I want to switch gears just for a second, if you don't mind, Bill, and it has to do with politics. And that is the, you mentioned it, the Boston School Committee, and the fact that it is not elected, and a recent decision by the school committee in almost a split vote. And I understand that the black woman made the decision to actually select the new superintendent, and the black woman, and I don't know who she is. She's on this
appointment. Jerry Robinson. Her name is Jerry Robinson.
Jerry Robinson. Now, the NAACP calls for the school committee decision to be reversed. And when I say reverse, I'm not talking about reverse the superintendent's decision, but reverse it back to looking for a new school superintendent. This is before the current superintendent that they just appointed got selected. But the black woman goes against the NAACP and says, guess what? We need to just go ahead and move forward. I'm kind of messed up with this. From the outside looking in, this is seems to be a cluster. I can't say that word on this network.
I know what you mean. It's
unbelievable. And by the way, we have online as well, and you know her, Brother Bill, is Sharon Hinton. She's the head of an organization called Black Teachers Matter. And I know both of you all have to have a conversation with me today about this whole issue of the Boston School decision, the Boston School Committee decision to hire a superintendent out of, Medford or Somerville.
Somerville. Well, please let Sharon go first. She's very, knowledgeable about this situation.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Young black kings trying to build a kingdom in the middle of some And the plantation.
In the plantation.
I am still disgusted, but this was in the works for, you know, this was in the works before the pandemic. And I say that because 3 days before the pandemic, Brenda Casellas, the outgoing, she's gone now because today is July 1st. So as of yesterday, she's gone. Brenda Casellas signed an MOU with Riley, with Commissioner Riley of DESE 3 days. So we're talking March 2020. And for the past 6 months, those of us who are on the ground listening had heard the name of Mary Skipper being floated about before there was even a search, you know, a formal search, a formal search committee, a formal firm that was hired to do the search. This was the most, and Bill, correct me if I'm wrong, this was the most accelerated search process over the last 10 superintendents. As a matter of fact, the superintendents before that took longer, at least up to a year, in one case, 18 months, because the pool wasn't diverse enough. The timeline of how this happened in terms of Brenda Casellas, and here's the rumor, not confirmed, because people are keeping their mouths shut because they want to keep their six figures intact and their political images intact. The rumor is that she was forced out, that Casellas was forced out. Now, you look at the fact that she had just been approved by the school committee, given with one abstention. There was one school committee member that didn't vote in her favor. He's no longer a school committee member. But everybody else said, oh, she did a great job. Let's extend her contract for 2 years. And then, you know, months later, she's like, I'm out. So it's like, whoa, how are you saying that you're going to be here and now you're out? You get paid for the rest of your contract. And so the, you know, the dog and pony show kicks in, but the whole step of the way, even with the vote. So let's clear something up. It wasn't just Jerry Robinson, who's the chair of the school committee, that didn't vote for the other candidate who fluently spoke Spanish, I think was a better candidate, Dr. Welch. They both had deep Boston backgrounds in terms of knowledge of Boston public schools. Even one of the Boston School Committee members, Brandon, had said, if I was going to pick either one of these candidates for my own nonprofit, I wouldn't make a decision in either one of them right now. But I'm part of the team, so I'm going to vote. So the Latino sister, we thought, those of us who were listening, because I testified that night to hold up the process, Tanisha Sullivan, president of the NAACP, there were over 30 organizations, BEAM included, that said, slow down the process. Let's not just go for this. The process itself is flawed. And it was ignored because the fix was in. you know, Mayor Wu was under the pressure of the receivership. I've recently, within the last 24 hours, heard conversations about people actually bringing Commissioner Riley under question for him putting this you know, accelerated process again, evaluating about the receivership with the Boston Public Schools and using that as a threat to force his decision. And there is a strong relationship between Mary Skipper and Riley. And so there's, you know, the conversations that happen in public to make it seem like it's transparent. You know, you can look at this, you can testify in this, and you can do that. And then there's opportunities for, you know, community members, parents, students. There were hearings to get the public's information about the job description for the incoming superintendent. That was public, parts of that were public. And then there were public discussions with the search firm, and that part was public. And then they went into closed door session when there were 34 possible candidates. And then two people came out. It was four people and then two people. So the other two people, one was Latina female, and, you know, the other one was African-American female, and they dropped out at the last minute. And so the discussion was, when everybody was saying, well, why don't you, not everybody, but a lot of people were saying, slow up the process and open it back up so we get diversity. And it was pushed through. It was pushed through. And one of the threats was that, well, if we don't do this and show stability, then DESE is going to come in and put everybody in the receivership. And by the way, the agreement that happened at the 11th hour with DESE and BPS does not take receivership inevitably off the table. It's the title of underperforming, which Riley was threatening to put on the Boston Public Schools, which was sort of a receivership-ish kind mm-hmm. of a relationship, because the mayor and he were going backward forward. You know, it was another one of those conversations where if you listen to the school committee meetings, even school committee members were saying, wait a minute, we didn't know about this, wait a minute. So it's obvious that, and the MOU, this new version of the MOU was signed by Jerry Robinson and the mayor and the commissioner. So it's like, well, what the heck, man? And she was even admitting in some of these meetings, she didn't know what was going on. So somebody was having these conversations, making decisions to make this agreement that all of the parents and the teachers and everything have to, and the students have to abide by, although the teachers still don't have a contract. BTU, Boston Teachers Union, is still in negotiations on their contract. And then you've got the mayor, you know, appointing the heads of the fire department, and she's going to appoint the head of the police department. And so all of us are saying, who the heck are you talking to? Who are you talking to, Zet?
Wow.
All of this, the verse, you know, 34, and there was even a presentation about the breakdown of all the candidates, the 34 candidates, how many were Black, how many made it to certain sessions. And then saying,
Dr. Hinton, wow, you're a ball of knowledge. I'll tell you, Bill Wright, come on in for a second. Thank you, Dr. Hinton, on your observations.
My last comment is out of all these diverse candidates, they still pick the white girl. Out of all of these diverse candidates, they still pick the white girl. And so it was a Latina woman on the school committee that also picked the white girl. So you can't just blame Black folks for having it together, because there's some shenanigans going on behind the scenes. And there's still the issue of elected versus appointed. That is a home rule petition that is on the slate. And we cannot let the mayor delay that until 2024 or 2025 and drag her feet and use the DESE receivership and use her stepping in and negating even the school committee in terms of her. There's a strong-handedness and a dictatorishness that's happening that needs to be checked by people of color, and specifically African-Americans in Boston.
Wow. That's a statement in itself. Dr. Sharon Hinton, thank you. Bill Wright. So you heard Sharon Hinton. She is obviously an insider on all this stuff that's going on in the Boston Public Schools. You've been an insider and outsider on this issue, as Sharon has. Sharon and you have worked for the Boston Public School System at one point back in the 70s and 80s and 90s. You've seen a lot, Bill. So what's your observations?
Well, I am also a graduate of Boston Public Schools.
Yes.
Boston Latin School, 1635. The first students at Harvard in 1636 were Boston Latin graduates. Uh-huh. But on this current issue, the hybrid school committee, have you heard about that?
Yeah, this is hybrid.
In the fall, the voters said, we wanted to return to an elected school committee.
Mm-hmm.
The elected mayor, Michelle Wu, has spoken about a hybrid school committee, which apparently means that some members would be appointed by the mayor and some would be elected by the residents of the city in different mm-hmm. districts. Mm-hmm. So if you were to imagine that, by the way, Jean McGuire, the first Black woman elected to the school committee citywide, in 1981, said that this creature, a hybrid school committee, has never existed anywhere. But imagine if the mayor's idea is pushed through and there was a hybrid committee.
Mm-hmm.
It's unworkable on its face, because you would have created two categories of school committee member.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say there's seven appointed by the mayor, so have her have the majority, and the other six are elected. The seven elected by the mayor would have the mayor's ear, yet the six elected by the people of the city, the citizens who pay the taxes, would be considered more legitimate because they were voted upon by the people whose children are the ones who go to the schools.
Correct.
So this hybrid nonsense is still something that the mayor seems to be clinging to, mm-hmm. when, again, it makes no sense. And as I said before, the process of gaining these political positions, the avenue had always been elected office into other positions of power in the city or in the state. And you know the history of Louise Day Hicks, who was one of the most atrocious people who was against integrating public schools in Boston. She went from school committee to city council to Congress.
Mm-hmm.
She would have never gotten that far if there was not an elected school committee.
So, but wait a minute. There is no successful hybrid school committee in any municipality or school system the size of Boston anywhere across this country. And when we ask, and when I say we, there was a coalition of educational advocates and nonprofits that met with Mayor Wu several weeks ago. And we asked her that question. If you are talking about a hybrid school committee model, where is the example that you're looking at that you can point that's successful? Because we've done the research and we haven't seen it. It doesn't exist.
What was the answer?
There are hybrid school committees, but they're homogenous, usually all white, and very small system. There is no successful model of a hybrid school committee in this country.
Well, can I address the elephant in the room, if you don't mind? You went to it for a minute, Sharon, and Brother Bill Wright, who was here with us on the live on All Things Black Politics, Bill as well. There's an elephant in the room. And the school system is now a small school system compared to how it used to be. Folks left in earnest back in the 1970s. In earnest, they left. I'm talking about South Boston, East Boston, Charlestown. They started running for the hills, running to, the South Shore and so forth. They ran. They left the city and it got gentrified out.
Parochial schools, private schools.
Parochial schools. Yeah. Just left.
Echo.
Just left. And here's the deal. I'm wondering, of the school system, the kids that are there, it seems to be a majority Black and Latino and Asian, some Asians, in the school system. But the decision has been made again in old classic Boston style. And there's the elephant in the room. Is that we say that we are wanting to transition to a place in which Black folks are represented, Black lives matter, Black teachers matter, Black educators matter, but we continue to appoint other people to systems that are actually supposed to support us.
Well, Leon, there's an important thing to understand about the current mayor.
Uh-huh.
When she was first on the city council, Michelle Wu voted for Bill Linehan of South Boston to be the city council president. Bill Linehan was Jimmy Kelly 2.0 type of South Boston politician.
Oh.
And when the progressives asked Wu why she did not support the other candidate, city councilor Ayanna Pressley, she answered that she felt that Linehan could manage the council better, which, of course, I guess means appointing certain people to certain committees, and perhaps she also meant banging the gavel.
Right.
But for her, that was more important than the positions that he took, or her own positions. And in return, she then was made the city council president a few years later. So there is the quid pro quo, which tells me all I ever need to know about Michelle Wu.
Well.
Wow. I didn't know all that was going on in the beautiful body politics of Boston, but you all are educating me big time. I'm just totally confused about what's going on with Boston politics. So let me go to something else. And thank you for that, educating me on education in Boston. Talk to us, if you don't mind, about the Senate race. Yeah, the Senate race. Bill Owens, many years ago, was able to successfully run for the first senator, Black senator, from Massachusetts in the House, Massachusetts Senate, excuse me, Massachusetts Senate. He won the second Suffolk district, and there has been people in that position since he won, and I enjoyed and knew and loved Bill Owens, amazing guy. Second Suffolk District, we got four candidates running. And why four candidates running? And why are the four candidates that are running, two are older, older gentlemen and an older woman, and two are younger? Does age matter? And does experience matter? And why are so many people running for the Second Suffolk District? Bill, first you, and then Sharon. What's your thoughts?
Well, I'm not sure about how people think about age, but y'all did elect a 78-year-old man to become president of the United States.
Joseph Biden. How's that looking out for us? Yeah.
and when they asked him if he's going to run for re-election in 2024, he said yes. So that would mean he's been running again when he's 82 years old. Yeah. Clearly, experience matters, right? But also, understanding what's going on today and knowledge and so forth matter as well. And, you know, I would put it to you this. If you went to many of the older Congress members who sometimes serve until they're 80 or 90 years old and asked them to, sit down at a computer and begin doing anything, right? Mm-hmm. They cost one of their aides. So it's not a whack as far as that goes. As for the four candidates, each of them has their supporters. Mm-hmm. And as you know, that seat is an open seat for state Senate because Sonia Chang Diaz, who had replaced Diane Wilkerson, ran for governor for a minute, and then after making it onto the ballot during the convention, decided to drop out because Mara Healy is a super strong candidate to be elected in Massachusetts over what's likely to be a Trump-supported Republican candidate.
Correct.
So, as you know, many of these seats sometimes are not open very often. Mm-hmm. So basically, Leon, people are going to shoot their shot.
Right. And so in people shooting their shot, you have two current state representatives, if I'm not mistaken, running for the office. You have Wilkerson running for the office. And you have Pastor Reverend Maynard Culpepper running for the office. Who has the strengths and who has the weaknesses?
Sharon, you still there?
I'm still here.
Your turn.
So let me. I know all of them. Nika, not as much, but yes. So my comment is that all four of them need to get in the room, figure out who's the strongest, and back them. Let's cut the deals like everybody else does, and look at, for the strategic positioning for the people that they're supposed to be representing, and not just self-interests. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a certain amount of ego that has to go into stealing. And when I mean steal, I mean S-T-E-E-L, like steely, being steely, because you're bringing yourself into it, your career, your money, your family, your reputation and everything. And so, you know, I my head is off to everybody who wants to run for office, because that's no joke. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about Black folks who identify as Black people in this city being marginalized strategically by other groups who are out organizing us, out financing us. And if we are still going to be players, we've got to play this like chess and not like checkers.
Right. And I would add that it's not only Black politicians who have made the mistakes of having, you know, several strong candidates in for the same seat and causing problems. The Mara Healy, a state rep, and Maureen Feeney were both running for a state Senate seat that historically had been Boston-based. Because neither of them was willing to drop out, Brian Joyce, a legislator from Milton, from the suburbs, was able to win the seat. Now, in some localities, a power broker type of politician would have sat down with the two, Mara and Maureen, and said, okay, Mara, your father was a state rep, you've been a state rep, it makes sense for you to move up to the state Senate. Maureen, you're a city councilor. When the next opportunity opens up, you get the chance, and we support you. That's what they do.
And that's what we should do, too. And that's what we should do, too, Bill. And I'm not saying follow the leader, but I'm saying follow gut political principles. And it's like, hey, guess what? Come together and let's win. Come together and let's win. Let's get right. the stronger candidate to be able right. to succeed. Go ahead, Bill. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to say with your Washington audience, Eric Holder, the former U.S. Attorney General, mm-hmm. was my classmate at Columbia College in 1969. And because he was a New York Knicks fan, I used mm-hmm. to wear my Celtics jersey. Mm-hmm. And Eric was very thin at 18 years old. Uh-huh. So I would push him around on the basketball court, not realizing that one day he would grow up to become the top law enforcement officer in the nation. What a country.
The one last thing I want to say is all skin folk and kin folk, and as a black community, we have to come together and really have a black agenda that says, just because you look like us doesn't mean we're automatically going to vote you in here. Let's look at your track record. Let's look at your policies. At least three of those people out of the four have a voting record and a legislative record. And we need to look at that to see if what they did is what they said when they were running for that office.
Wow. Well, you've said, both of you all have said a lot today, and I'd love to have this continued conversation with both of you all. I also want to bring in another dear friend of mine moving forward, Joe Delgado, who is in Arizona, but he says that he's going to make himself available as well to have the conversation about what is going on in Boston. From outside looking in, I appreciate you all, Brother Bill Wright and Sister Sharon Hinton, for joining in on the conversation today. And by the way, this is a to-be-continued conversation on all things Black politics, live here in Washington, D.C. Again, thank you, Bill Wright, and thank you, Sharon Hinton.
Thank you, Dr. Rock.
Thank you, Leon Rock.
Okay, see you all later. Have a good day.
Peace.
Bye.
You're the king on the throne.
Recording stopped.